An absolute bombshell was dropped by the Houston Chronicle, and Brent Zwerneman was on the other end of it over at the Houston Chronicle. Breaking news as Texas and Oklahoma were set to join the Southeastern Conference was the report, and this was happening while Texas A&M was being presented at SEC Media Days. It was almost a perfect storm of this type of story. You could see Jimbo Fisher being asked about it real time. He wasn't prepared for it. It was an absolute incredible story, and it looks like this is going to happen. And I believe this could be the biggest story maybe in college football history if this goes down, especially within like the last 25 to 50 years.
It's 100% up there, and it makes me wonder how the news was broken. Was Texas A&M trying to get out and like out in front of it? Because there's no reason for a Texas reporter to be there. Obviously, Brent broke the story. So was he trying to help A&M be like, look, this is happening right now, and like, this is your chance on a public platform to make a statement?
Well, we will.
We can ask him.
We can ask him now. Right now. Brent Zwerneman is he covers Texas A&M for the Houston Chronicle. He's also authored 5 books for them.
Jesus.
On A&M. Yes, a lot smarter than us, Lloyd.
He'll take the ACT.
We welcome Brent into the conversation now. Good morning, Brent. Thank you for our time. Thank you for your time.
Hey, good morning. On those books, you know, it's just take them one chapter at a time, and you're good to go.
Thank you for the guidance. We're gonna let you write those.
All I see is the blinking line when you start the page. You're like, never mind.
Brent, what was your cell phone like on Wednesday?
That was crazy. And Wednesday was the day. You know, I enjoyed, you know, LSU, because we have obviously in Houston a big LSU following. So Monday was good, but Wednesday was the day I was looking forward to. Nick Saban, Jimbo Fisher, who I cover, Mike Leach. I mean, it was already shaping up to be just a great news day on that front. And then I go and get word of that. I even briefly considered, damn, maybe this could wait till Thursday. No, better be now. But, yeah, the idea that A&M had this orchestrated event to really get the word out is not correct, which, I mean, it was just, really, it was an amazing coincidence. But here's what it comes down to, and I mentioned this several times, you know, and I mentioned it in the stories. That day, that Wednesday, was the 10-year anniversary to the day that then Texas A&M President Arbo and Lofton had stepped out of a Regents meeting at A&M and said, the Big 12 is in a state of uncertainty. And what he meant by that was A&M wanted to get out of there. And then so then things accelerated from there. So what it stemmed from was, I had reached out to all these old contacts across the board, across leagues, across SEC, Big 12, and so forth, to talk about that 10-year anniversary. So if you look back at my Twitter timeline, you'll see that I'm referencing 10 years Lofton in this story. Here's a new book on this. So I had reached out to all these old contacts. It just happened to come down right at that time, which was kind of nuts, you know, because actually I had been trying to post it much earlier. But I was having trouble. Y'all might remember this. Having trouble with the Wi-Fi at SEC Media Days, scrambling around out in the lobby, going outside where that big sign is on the outside of the hotel, trying to. And then I started using my hotspot. And then for the first time in days, the sun comes out, so I can barely see the screen on my laptop. So the idea of this very well-oiled A&M has, you know, leaked this and here post it now. No, that didn't happen at all. In fact, it was supposed to be earlier in the day, but it got pushed back.
Wow. I said coming in that if this happens, and at this point it doesn't feel like if, it feels like when, Oklahoma and Texas announce that they're joining the league, how big of a story this is for college football. Brent, I would say that this possibly could be the biggest story ever, or when you look at least the last 25 to 50 years of the sport when conferences became as relevant as they are now, and we've seen the amount of money that's being made around college sports, particularly college football. In your opinion, how big, if this story breaks, if Oklahoma and Texas do join the league, do join the Southeastern Conference, what does that mean for college sports?
Yeah, it's the start of what I anticipate. At that time, the thought was, okay, SEC being on the cutting edge, as they always are, becomes the first 16-team super conference. And so SEC once again leading the way. And then you start hearing things, well, they might add more. And I've joked that at some point it's going to be 32 teams each, and it's going to be called West and East. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah, you're right. Going to have two conferences of that. But, yeah, the idea is the SEC is going to be out front on this, be the first super conference, ideally a 16-team, four super conferences. Texas and Oklahoma, from the vantage of being traditional, you know, if you're going to talk about SEC being a football league, I mean, those are two programs you obviously would love to add, in OU and Texas. Texas hasn't been very good for the past decade, but certainly they have the pedigree and they absolutely have the money. Oklahoma has been good in that span, so it's no brainer. So if you're Greg Sankey, are you saying, and they come to you, are you saying, no thanks, you know, go ahead and go to the ACC or the Big Ten? No, you're wanting to add those guys. And so those talks were behind the, you know, behind the scenes for a while. I've never still pegged down exactly how long this had been going on. In my mind, it wasn't that long. But, yeah, it's certainly the tipping point. I will say this. I had the discipline of a decade ago, having covered A&M, you know, in Missouri, obviously on a smaller scale, having gone through this. So I already know all the procedures and everything that go with it, the eventual vote that will come to be. I saw all that with Texas A&M, so I kind of have an idea of what's going to go on here. And once it came out public here, I think that does accelerate the process in terms of moving it forward. Because A&M was supposed to be like a two-year deal at that time. They would be joining the SEC in 2013, maybe 2014, 3 years. But it was so awkward, that one fall of football, you know, and everything, or it became awkward early on. They accelerated the process and moved it up, and the Big 12 agreed to it. And next thing you know, within a year, they're playing in the SEC. It would not surprise me to be to see a situation like this with Texas and OU as well.
Brent Zwerneman joining us here on the Jordy Culotta Show. You can find him on Twitter there. He covers Texas A&M for the Houston Chronicle. He was the one who broke the story last Wednesday, the bombshell that has rocked college sports and has everybody in our business talking. And if you turn on sports radio, if you open up your internet to your go-to sports feed, everybody is talking about this story of Texas and Oklahoma.
Thank God he did it.
Potentially, yes, joining the league. Texas A&M meets today, their Board of Regents, at 4 o'clock. That Ross Bjork was speaking over the weekend about what potentially this could mean. I've even seen where Texas state legislation has crafted a bill that may take a vote on whether or not schools can lead their conferences. What has been the feeling since last Wednesday in and around your state, and specifically to the team that you cover in Texas A&M, since this news has hit the public?
Jordy, you've probably seen the pivot that's going on with Texas A&M. Ross Bjork was on hand. And that's another thing. I'd ask him, have you been to SEC Media Days before? He said he had gone three times while he was Ole Miss athletic director. So A&M, so that wasn't some new deal where he was there suddenly to ask questions. In fact, he was quite caught off guard, saying A&M wanted to be the only SEC school from the state of Texas. In that time, I started coming around and saying, okay, whoever the SEC brings on, we'll welcome them, and we'll try to beat them on the field. So this Regents meeting that was called back on Thursday or Friday, or when they had to announce it publicly, but essentially I was told, it's just to update them on the latest. They have to announce it if they're going to get together by phone, by teleconference, and discuss what's going on. The legislators, it's exactly what happened a decade ago, where there's a lot of talk, not a lot of action. There was a lot of threats toward Texas A&M from Baylor a decade ago that ultimately led nowhere. So you can kind of see all that playing out. Some politicians feel like they have to stick up for Texas Tech and Baylor, TCU, and programs like that, but ultimately there's not just a whole lot they can do about it, especially when Texas A&M is now adopting the approach of saying, hey, things have been pretty good for the Aggies in the SEC. They will welcome anyone, you know, they're not particularly happy about it, but they're going to go along with it and then try to beat the heck out of them on the football field.
Brent, you mentioned that you are familiar with the process. What do you anticipate now as the timeline goes on? Because I've seen reports that this could be announced as early as this week.
Yeah, I think today OU and Texas are formally letting the Big 12 know that they don't want to extend the TV rights, which is kind of that first formal step. Then the SEC at some point can formally invite. I do think it's going to follow that process of being accelerated, especially if, say, like the Pac-12 says, man, we'd like to add these eight remaining teams, and suddenly you have a 20-team super conference out west. Obviously, those leftover Big 12 teams would jump on that opportunity to be a part of a big league. So I could see it accelerating. It accelerated 10 years ago when it appeared the Big 12 was going to survive. Texas and OU were going to stick with it. And then suddenly Baylor's like, okay, we're all right. We're in this league. I could see that playing out. Now, if it looks like these Big 12 programs are going to be kind of whipping in the wind on all this, then they'll take every step they can to kind of draw it out so they can be part of a you know, so-called Power Five conference as they search for a landing spot. But my gut feeling is on all this is that it's going to move pretty quick because it does become an awkward situation. I can give you an example from a personal perspective. Anytime I've covered an A&M at Iowa State game when they were in the Big 12, parked right by the stadium, walked right up to the press box, nice, settled in, very nice people, name's Iowa. That last time I went, in 2011, when A&M was headed out of the Big 12 and for the SEC, I'm not sure that they parked me in Ames. I might not have even been in that county. And it was raining that day, and I'm trudging across this cornfield and going, yeah, okay, it's time for the Aggies to go ahead and make that move. And I'm not even an Aggie. Right. So I just cover the program. So anyway, I could it becomes very awkward across the board if you have some lame duck programs competing in your conference. So I could see it being accelerated.
Can you give us an idea of those that may not be familiar with if this rivalry is rejuvenated between Texas and Texas A&M, just how much hate there is?
Oh, it's incredible. I grew up in this state, you know, in the state of Texas. And from the time I was a little kid, and I wasn't even an Aggie or a Longhorn or whatever, or wouldn't become one of those, but I had family members on both sides. And it was great. It was the biggest sporting event of the year that I look forward to. And I feel for these kind of younger Texans right now who've missed out on it the past decade. But it's continued, and they say the rivalry plays out in recruits' living rooms. Well, that's nice, but I think people want to see it on the field. And like I said, there's going to be an awful lot of slobber coming out of helmets and things like that first meeting, because there's so much pent-up frustration on both sides. And as an eyewitness to it, they need that to let out those frustrations. Like, it's all pent up, and it's been kind of crazy in the past decade, and you don't have that release of an actual game to see what happens on the field. So I, for one, am really looking forward to it. I thought they should have kept playing as non-conference opponents on Thanksgiving weekend. That didn't happen, but now they're going to be forced to play anyway, and it's going to be a huge moneymaker for both programs, which, as we know, these programs and these universities are starting to try to figure out where they're going to get their money from moving forward with things like NIL coming into play.
Brent Zwerneman's joining us here on the Jordy Culotta Show. He's over at the Houston Chronicle covering Texas A&M. He's a great follow on Twitter. You can find him there at his name, at Brent Zwerneman, is the Twitter handle. Yes, last week the media polls came out for the SEC from the preseason and had Texas A&M second in the West behind Alabama and ahead of LSU. How'd you like where the Aggies finished in the pecking order, and where are they under Jimbo Fisher heading into this season?
I think that's about accurate. Their biggest question by far is on the offensive line. They lost four starters, so they've got to replace four starters. The guy they return is an All-American, Kenyon Green, the left tackle. So obviously that's a key position for him. You've got to replace Kellen Mond, four-year starter at quarterback, but they have two guys that Jimbo Fisher said will be in the NFL at some point, and he knows what that looks like, and Haynes King and Zach Calzada. And you have some of the best running backs in the nation, you know, starting with Isaiah Spiller. So you have some guys you can take the pressure off that O-line, especially take the pressure off the quarterback. The defense was really, really good last year. Just about all those guys are back. I mean, they had four or five of those super seniors return, which is something, because a few of them would have been drafted. So, yeah, things are shaping up for it to be a really exciting season for the Aggies. I've always said if they were ever going to win a division crown, it was going to be in an odd year, because that's when Alabama and Auburn come to Kyle Field with the setup. And so that, you know, Aggies already have October 9th with Nick Saban and crew coming to town circle twice on the calendar. So yeah, it's shaping up as what should be a promising year for the Aggies. They finished fourth in the AP poll last year, which was their highest finish in the AP since they won the national title in 1939, which is incredibly telling, because, you know, they've taken a lot of pride in wrecking through defenses over the years and everything, but to finally get a top four finish, you know, obviously points in the right direction for Jimbo. And what was his third year? In his fourth year at Florida State, he won a national title, and A&M fans are hoping that history repeats itself there.
Yeah, I was going to ask you what the feeling with the locals on Fisher is going into year four.
Oh, they love him around here, as you can imagine. I mean, he's just a good fit, because A&M has always, as y'all know, it's just a really, really passionate place with a passionate fan base. And that passion always hasn't always been matched by the head coaches, whether it's Dennis Franchione or Mike Sherman and Kevin Sumlin. Jimbo is a guy who's all in. I mean, and he is fired up, and y'all are aware of him out there and so forth. And, man, he just loves football. He loves coaching football. And, in fact, you know, however long ago it was, 5-6 years ago, when it looked like Jimbo was going to be headed to LSU and someone was still around at A&M, I remember thinking, man, these LSU butt kickings at A&M are just going to keep continuing now. They're going to intensify, you know, and really my seeing what he's done with A&M in a very short time, it really hasn't changed my opinion in terms of his coaching. And he loves the passion. He loves the fact that 102,000 people are going to pack in there and that they just live and breathe football around here 365 days a year. I mean, it's an environment y'all are familiar with. I love the games over there. It was just a great setting. So yeah, really look forward to the future. And the fact that, you know, let's say they split it up where Alabama and Auburn go east. And I don't know, you know, I haven't heard anything official on that. But to add Texas and Oklahoma to the schedule for LSU and A&M, I mean, good times ahead. That's my thought.
Will addition of Texas kind of slow down the rivalry talk or the steam between LSU and Texas A&M that it feels like the league is trying to push?
It does, because I think it would be a no-brainer for A&M and Texas to suddenly be back on Thanksgiving and Thanksgiving weekend. And really, we've seen it. I mean, it's been a good little rivalry between LSU and A&M. Then you say you have Houston in common as a recruiting base, East Texas, West Louisiana, and so forth on down the line. And obviously some great storylines that have come from the games over the past few years. But, yes, there's no doubt that there is one true rival, and that hasn't changed with them not even playing in football, and that's Texas for the Aggies. Although I do think it could be like the old days when A&M and LSU played as non-conference rivals, and that was a really, really good series back in the day. It would certainly continue to be a marquee matchup. There's no doubt about it. But, yeah, A&M would have its rival back, and they're only separated by what I always called 100 country miles here between College Station and Austin. So a whole lot of interaction, a whole lot of family members, all those kind of things that attend both universities.
Last one, Brent, we'll get you out of here. Thank you for your time on this Monday morning. When it comes down to the vote this week, or seemingly this week, of SEC schools, whether or not to allow Texas and Oklahoma into the league, do you anticipate that being 13-1, or do you anticipate Texas A&M voting a yay?
Yeah, and I'm not sure it'll be that quick on the actual vote, because those things are drawn out in terms of they want to – the SEC, as I recall, really wants to make sure it crosses all its T's and dots and I's in this, so there's no question about it. But I do think, going back to the beginning of the conversation, at the very beginning, you could see that A&M's trying to put things in motion. When I say the very beginning, back to Wednesday when the story broke, of trying to line up LSU and Arkansas and Missouri and so forth, to try to get those four – teams to vote against it, because you've got to have 11 of the 14 to say yes. Right now, I would say it's going to be 14-0, because why would A&M come out and very publicly say that they are in favor of, you know, any and all comers, that they trust the SEC moving forward, and then vote against it? So I think it's going to be a unanimous vote.
Brent Zwerneman is over at the Houston Chronicle. He's a fantastic follow on Twitter, especially if you want to keep up with the latest on the Texas A&M news. And as we said, he had the breaking story over at the Chronicle last week of Texas, Oklahoma reaching out to SEC about joining the conference. That has absolutely been an explosion in the college sports world that has everybody talking. So we appreciate, Brent, your time very much here on this Monday morning. Thank you for stopping by.
Enjoyed it. Thank y'all.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate you having me on, Jordy. We'll see you.
Yes, sir. There is Brent Zwerneman checking in from Houston this morning. As he is over in, he's actually over in College Station as he covers A&M over there for the Chronicle, and he was the one who authored and had the source last week of Texas and Oklahoma reaching out to the league about becoming their 15th and 16th members to the Southeastern Conference. And like we said, I haven't seen a news outlet. I haven't seen a website. I haven't seen a message board. I haven't seen anything that covers sports since then that is not talking about this.